Blackstone Audio presents Hold a Scorpion by Melodie Johnson Howe. This book is read by Marguerite Gavin. For Bones, who brings love and music to my life. The beat goes on. Chapter 1. I was bigger than life, running down the streets of Barcelona. It was late afternoon, and I sat in the dark watching myself on the big screen. The theater was sparsely attended, but that had nothing to do with the lack of an audience. The film was a flop, a turkey, a dud. It fit my mood. Over lunch and too much wine, I had broken up with my lover. His wounded voice rattled in my head. He told me that no man was ever going to live up to my expectations, that no man was ever going to please me, that I would end up old and alone, and I should take a good look at myself. So I did. I went to see a movie I was in. Watching my image on the screen always splits me in two. The narcissistic side of me wallows in delight at my being loved by the camera, but narcissism is as demanding as an unpaid drug dealer. The other side of me, the sharp as an axe critic, reminds me of the destructiveness of falling in love with my own image. I may look 10 years younger, but I was still 41, old by Hollywood standards. As my ex-lover warned, I could end up alone. And on top of all that, I was running to my death in a fiasco of a film. Why I had to die was still as unclear as it was on the day I shot the scene. It was only obvious to Pedro Romero, the great Mexican director making his first American movie. An auteur of small, influential films, he had been welcomed to Hollywood with a ton of money and an array of special effects. He, and therefore I and the other actors, had drowned in Hollywood's largesse and Romero's ego. The only stars left standing were the special effects guys, which meant the movie was big in China because they loved special effects, but it was still a flop in America. I, who usually kept my hope in check, had had such faith in this movie. I thought it would secure me larger roles and more money. I had fallen into the Hollywood trap of "this is my big chance" syndrome. I knew better. You just take the parts as they come, and you go on. Closing my eyes against my fleeing image, against the memory of my ex-lover's stiffening jaw and hurt eyes, I fell asleep. When I awoke with a start, feeling slightly hungover, the theater was empty and the movie had begun again. It hadn't gotten any better, but I should have stayed to watch it one more time. Chapter 2. The sun was balancing on the rim of the ocean, its light slanting into the driver's side window of my old green Jag, warming my left cheek. Traffic was heavy as I headed to my home on PCH, Pacific Coast Highway, in Malibu. Surfers, finished for the day, were strapping their boards on the top of their cars parked along the side of the road. Some had unzipped their wetsuits down to their narrow, pale hips, then wrapped long towels like sarongs around their waists. Now they were adeptly slipping their wetsuits off beneath their chaste covering. In all my years of living in Malibu, I had never seen one towel fall. But there is always hope. In an ode to bad taste, the American Apparel building rose up, jarringly out of place with its baby blue tinted windows reflecting its big asphalt parking lot, draped with a banner that declared, "Our clothes are made in downtown Los Angeles." Hollywood isn't the only business that thrives on hype. Now the ocean disappeared from sight and all there was to see were homes lining the coast. Jammed together and vying for space, they cut off any view of the Pacific. Mine was among them. As I drove into my carport, Ryan Johns was waiting for me with a bouquet of flowers.
"I need to talk with you."
He pulled open the car door. "You brought me flowers?"
"No. Did you break up with the ego?"
That's what he called my now ex-lover, Peter Bianchi. "I did."
"About time. I think they're from him."
"You read the card?"
"I got bored waiting."
He was wearing his usual outfit. Hawaiian shirt, baggy Bermuda shorts, and Uggs. Did he leave them? I didn't like the idea of Peter Bianchi driving to my house after we broke up.
"I don't know. I've had a revelation.
Ryan was bouncing nervously on the balls of his feet. I opened the card. It read,
You'll be sorry, Diana. You'll never find a man as right for you as I am.
I sighed. I didn't want a man who knew he was right for me.
Diana, did you hear what I said? This is important.
Ryan moved in front of me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.